Log4Shell and Log4j explained, Google disrupts a major botnet, and NPM packages steal Discord credentials. All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morse, and this is ThreatWire for December 14th, 2021. This is your weekly summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. Thank you so much to longtime patron David for the upgrade, and to Bri for joining this week on Patreon. Patreon.com/ThreatWire, as always, to keep the show ad-free. And if you want to support the show, but you don't want to be on Patreon, I understand. You can grab your own ThreatWire merchandise just for the holidays at the link below with a coupon code TURKEY for 15% off, because it started on Thanksgiving, so hence TURKEY. And with that, onto the news. Now, I know y'all are all here for this Log4Shell attack, so let's go ahead and get right into it. On Thursday of last week, this new vulnerability started showing up online via news sources and within the InfoSec community. By the weekend, it had become widely known to be a huge concern given its ease of attack and the potential for compromising servers given its attack surface is relatively ubiquitous and used across millions of applications. Log4Shell is tracked as CVE-2021-44228 and is the nickname given to a critical zero-day vulnerability, and it has a maximum severity score of 10, meaning that it's a problem. Yeah, it's a big problem. This attack was first noted in the wild to be used against a Minecraft server in a remote code exploitation, but the reason the Minecraft server was compromised also affects millions of other apps and servers because the source of the problem is used by so many, and the source is called Log4j. So Log4j is an open source Java utility by Apache built into a bunch of applications that easily logs user input and performs network lookups within the JNDI, or the Java Naming and Directory interface, to obtain services from LDAP, which is LDAP, for Lightweight Directory Access Protocol. Log4j captures a message as a URL, fetches the correct response, and it can execute code with full privileges. So researchers found out that this can be exploited in text by using a specific syntax. An attacker could scan for vulnerable servers, they could find one, and use a text box to enter a line of code to trigger the Log4j utility to start a lookup. But instead of just allowing you to do something like a user would, i.e. logging into your Apple ID or connecting to a Minecraft server or whatever, this would allow them to do things like install a crypto miner, or grow a botnet, or exfiltrate data from the targeted server. A great example of this is changing your iPhone's name on your iPhone in the settings to the delegated syntax, which triggers the vulnerability on Apple's servers, as this red teamer shared on Twitter. Yesterday, Tom Anthony, CTO of Search Pilot, pointed out that if you don't close the payload with a closing bracket, it will just keep exfiltrating data until the next bracket comes along. So that's great. Yeah, that's just great. So what's the explanation that you can actually tell your family when they see the TV news mention it in a one-liner just to freak everybody out and get clicks? Well, luckily, CTO of Sonatype, Ika Turunen, hopefully I didn't butcher your name, gave me this comparison. It's like a captain's log on a ship, but for software. This allows programs to record what happens when it runs, and usually when a user enters something simple into a text form, it's kind of boring stuff, like changing your iPhone's name. But someone somewhere found out that you can enter that code into these text fields to make the app do weird stuff. For admins, they gotta update the app. And they gotta update anything else that they use written in Java. And a lot of companies just don't know what components go where, so they gotta look at literally everything to make sure each and every bit is patched. That's what makes this so serious. Even though it was publicly disclosed last week, Matthew Prince, co-founder and CEO of Cloudflare, tweeted that they saw evidence of it being used in the wild as early as December 1st. That means that it has been used for a while before anyone even knew about the problem. A GitHub page shows potential impact, and while not verified, it does include a slew of potentially affected brands, including Twitter, Steam, Apple, Tesla, Amazon, Unify, WebEx, LinkedIn. There's so many more. There's also an extensive list of responses that have already come out from brands linked on GitHub as well. Researchers have explained that if you use Apache Struts, you are likely vulnerable. Sadly, users can't do much, since this requires app configurations and server updates for programs and websites that you use. The best users can do is alert the industries that they rely on to check for the vulnerable utility and make sure to update. Services should update Log4j to version 2.15.0 as reported, but it's kind of like putting out a ton of little fires. One app can use a ton of additional backend programs to run, and each of those might be using Log4j as well. Microsoft and Sophos both have intensive articles explaining how you can prevent, detect, and hunt down any exploitation of this vulnerability if you are an admin, and many companies have already started patching, luckily. But for the meantime, please treat your fellow InfoSec employees and admins with some empathy and patience through this holiday season. I am sure that a lot of folks are working overtime to patch this problem with zero thanks, so let me be the one to say thank you for your hard work. You deserve a raise for all that you do to keep users protected. Botnets are still alive and well at the end of 2021, but Google has stepped in to disrupt one botnet that has infected 1 million devices at least. This botnet is coined Glooptaba or Gluptaba, and it infects Windows machines. Operators were using Google's services to disrupt the botnet, so with the help of the Cybercrime Investigation Group, Google's Threat Analysis Group terminated 63 million Google Docs, 1183 Google accounts, 908 cloud projects, and 870 Google ads that were being used. But Gluptaba is still being spread using the Bitcoin blockchain as its command and control server for resilience. Google Tag also worked with hosting and infrastructure providers to remove servers hosting the botnet and put a warning page in front of the malicious domains. Google has taken it a step further by filing a lawsuit as well against who they allege are behind the operation of this botnet. Google filed a lawsuit in the Southern District of New York against two Russian defendants, stating that they have infiltrated over 1 million computers and devices to create this botnet for illicit purposes, such as stealing Google users' login credentials. But that's not all. Gluptaba was also being used to steal account information, vend credit cards to create fraudulent purchases via Google Ads, serve up pop-up ads on compromised machines, and mine cryptocurrency. This botnet was first documented a decade ago, and it just keeps on going. This disruption will help, but it likely will not be the end of its spread. I love it when y'all send me these adorable pictures of your pets. So these are a few from my Hush Puppy Patreon Alliance members. They're such cute fur babies. You can always support this content and keep it ad-free for as little as $2 a month and get a slew of perks at the same time. Each and every single Alliance member gets over 10 perks as soon as you sign up at patreon.com/threatwire. And with that, on to the third news story. The open source package repository called NPM was being used to distribute 17 malicious packages that are being used to steal credentials and information on Discord servers. Now, while Discord is usually used for user communication and community, it's also used as command and control channels for botnets, as well as a proxy for downloading data. Attackers appear to have used a series of techniques to trick developers into downloading the malicious package instead of a legitimate one. They're able to do this because repositories are trusted by developers and machines, so no flags are raised whenever communications happen between the repo and the dev platform. Automated installations, such as using the NPM client, also create a quote, ripe attack vector, according to two JFrog researchers who discussed this and discovered the attack vector via a post published on Wednesday. The malicious NPM packages work in a variety of ways. A few are purported to be the discord.js library, but they actually include malicious code. Another one acts like a Discord bot that fixes errors, but it actually steals credit card information. A third example that they disclosed includes a remote access Trojan. Now, while these specific packages have been removed from NPM's repositories, if you download a lot of open source packages, it is crucial to only download them from legitimate sources. Do you want more tech content? Subscribe over at youtube.com/ShannonMorse for example, my gift guides this month. Don't forget to like and subscribe to this channel as well. Next week is my annual Biggest Hacks of 2021 video for this year, and then I will be out for the holidays and back in January after CES. I am Shannon Morse, and I'll see you on the internet.